semester here at the Institute for Advanced Study to work on her new project. So it's been really wonderful having her here, and we will be having you come down all the way from Duluth, certainly when you're back up there. So Natalie received her PhD in 2014, so fairly recently, from the University of Chicago in Russian history, and is working now on a new project on the internal population displacement in the Soviet Union during World War II. She has a range of interests and brings to the Center for Jewish Studies an area that we really have not had. So it's really been wonderful, and I'm thrilled that she will be speaking to us today with this wonderful title, Am I a Zhid? Anti-Semitism on the Soviet Home Front During the Second World War. So please join me in welcoming Natalie.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to thank the Center of Jewish Studies, of course, Leslie and Dr. Morris and Dr. Paradise for inviting me to give this talk. It's really a pleasure, and for inviting me to be a visiting scholar. It's at the center this semester. It's been a real pleasure to, no shade on Duluth, I love our campus very much, but it's been a real pleasure to be here, certainly to be at the Institute for Advanced Study, and to be able to meet all the great faculty and students here, and to have that opportunity has been really extremely valuable and treasured for me. Just a few points on lexicon. The title here, Am I a Zhid? I will come back to it in the talk itself, but just to explain, Zhid is the term for Jew in Polish, just means Jew in Polish, but in Russian it is an offensive term. The best translation I know of is kai. So that's just then that's kind of where it comes from. So this Am I a Zhid, the term Zhid came to be thrown around on the Soviet home front, and that's what I'm going to be talking about. But I'd like to begin my presentation today actually by sharing with you a few minutes from this this wonderful song that I know it's very didactic to like give a handout at the beginning of a talk, but and I do apologize that it's relatively small type. But it is a song entitled Kazakhstan that recently came out in this wonderful collection that I can highly recommend called Yiddish Glory of songs from the Soviet Union, I think the subtitle is Lost Songs from the War, songs from the Soviet Union. Here it's noted that the lyrics are anonymous, but it was recorded in 1945. And I have the translation. The song is itself in Yiddish, but the translation. I have the translation into English and Russian for those of you who are for Russian. So let me just go. Oh,
Jetzt kommt zu der Mischpoche noch ein Glied. Bei uns bist du ein Bruder, jeder Bruder, jeder. Zu weinen und zu klagen. Und die Welt tut mir sagen, oh, tut mir sagen. Jetzt kommt zu der Mischpoche noch ein Glied. Bei uns bist du ein Bruder, jeder Bruder,
that I will discuss in the next half hour or so. As this song relates, over a million Jewish refugees and evacuees survived the war in the Soviet Union, specifically on the unoccupied areas of the Soviet home front. In fact, it's important to note that this represents the largest contingent of survivors on the European continent. Some of these people were evacuees who had been who had fled or have been evacuated by Soviet authorities from the western parts of the Soviet Union. So I go between these maps just because Soviet Union is just really big and it's really hard to get on a slide in a way that anyone can make anything out. But individuals who've been evacuated from Belarus, Ukraine, the western parts of the Russian Federative Republic, represented there. Others were Polish Jews who had fled east or had been deported by Soviet authorities between 39 and 41, which is a somewhat separate story, and then liberated in the summer of 41 when the Soviet Union reestablished relations with the Polish government in exile. So that kind of refers to mostly Jews who came from the areas annexed by the Soviets in 1939, also some who fled from the German annexed territories ended up in the Soviet annexed territories and then ended up being evacuated or being deported. There's, you know, for the about 1.25 million that we expect were there, there's an equal number of stories, so yeah, we could be here for a long time. Others were from Romania or the Baltic states and even the lands further west. Many would find themselves resettled, resettled to Central Asia. Not just Central Asia, but these were some of the key places, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, as well as further north in Siberia. So this kind of brings me to the title of that song, Kazakhstan, a place you don't usually associate with Jewish life. Central Asia in general, you don't really associate with Jewish life, but here it is. As this song depicts, even for Soviet Jews, the encounter with the lands of Central Asia was a jarring one. This was far from the topography that most Eastern European Jews were familiar with. The environment, the culture, the languages, the lifestyles, all of this was quite foreign, and in many ways this area represents a great unknown. Reflected, I think, well in the lyrics of the song, it was the storm wind that brought me to into Asia, and now I've learned that this land called Kazakhstan exists. Did not know that it exists before. And many people, just as the song articulated, again, what a land it is, surrounded by mountains, but just as the song articulated, one of the main things people were wondering was, oh, mountains, tell me, mountains, what do you want from me? In other words, what kind of fate awaited them there? How would they be received? How would they survive? And as the song indicates, I've arrived here naked and sickly, only with little pieces of scraps, right? So most people came with very few resources at their disposal, understandably. They were refugees when you're being evacuated or deported, or the Nazis are about to come into your town. You're not able to really take the multiple pieces of luggage with you. In this song, the mountains respond, the Soviet mountains, which I love that, the Soviet mountains that have the No Lenin's Torah, which is a fun little expression in and of itself, reassure the refugees that they would find safety and peace in the Soviet Union, assuring them that all the peoples of the Soviet Union, be they Jewish, Kazakh, Ukrainian, or Georgian, were welcome there, and unlike the Germans, they would not be cast out, but would instead be part of a Soviet family. This is kind of part of the great, larger Soviet narrative of the Soviet Union as the state that embraced this notion of friendship of the peoples, that brought in people of different ethnicities and nationalities, and respected their differences. Of course, the realities were significantly more complex than that. Today, I'd like to examine in part whether the Soviet Union managed to deliver on that promise and articulated in the song. And I'd like to examine how the evacuation experience impacted some of those involved and the way it affected notions of Jewishness in the Soviet Union. First of all, it's important to note that Jewish evacuees and refugees in the Soviet Union were certainly, no doubt about it, in a better position than those who were in the occupied territories of Europe, basically. There was not certainly at any point by the Soviets an all-out policy to destroy or exterminate evacuees or Jewish evacuees specifically. The Soviet regime did not pursue anti-Semitic policies during the war. Strangely enough, the Soviets kind of adopted more of an anti-Semitic agenda after the war, because that's clearly a great idea after 6 million Jews have been killed. And authorities attempted to clamp down on expressions of anti-Semitism. So this is certainly a different story. However, it is important to mention that these promises, as I'm guessing many of you can already tell, were often not delivered. And what we do have is kind of a ground, anti-Semitic sentiments coming out on the Soviet home front that kind of go against this notion that the Soviet Union welcomed everyone and that anti-Semitism did not exist there. So to get to the narratives of wartime anti-Semitism, what were some of the sources of anti-Semitism on the home front? First of all, rumors circulated about Jews sitting out the war. This was an accusation that was relatively common in the Soviet Union during the war. It's completely and utterly baseless. Multiple statistics exist to show that Jews were fighting on the front. on the front lines and in the Red Army to a greater percentage than people of other nationalities, actually. But the rumors circulated that Jews were sitting out the war in the East while Russians and others were fighting to, quote-unquote, defend the Jews from the Germans. And this was a common rumor, this notion that Jews were fighting on the Tashkent Front in Central Asia, and the jokes circulated about how Jews had supposedly occupied Tashkent and Alma-Ata, which were never occupied by, well, remained Soviet the whole war. Jews were overrepresented within the evacuee community in comparison to their proportion within the USSR more broadly. Our best statistics tell us that there was about 16.5 million evacuees, Soviet evacuees in general. Jews made up about probably 1 million of those. That is obviously a minority, but it is a greater proportion than Jews represented within the Soviet Union. This was in part because evacuation initiatives targeted urban areas in the western parts of the Soviet Union where most Jews lived. Plus the added fact that Jews were kind of more sensitive to the threat. Some Jews were more sensitive to the threat posed by Nazi occupation. Because of their relative visibility, Jews were often scapegoated for many of the problems brought about population displacement. What you had is millions of people coming into areas, towns like cities in Tashkent and Alma-Ata and smaller regional areas. It's not hard to imagine that what happens instantly is overcrowding, scarcities, rationing, right? Things get difficult. This particularly begins to kind of hit home by the winter of 41 to into 42, when it's clear that all the news coming from the front is bad. It's clear that the evacuees are there to stay. And that winter is coming, and that the sort of patriotism that you had in the summer and early fall goes away, and people are hit with the realities of how do we cope with these millions of people who we need to provide for, and it's not clear when they're going to be able to go home, if ever, because the war is not ending, and did not end for another 4 years. One important point of contention was shared housing. And one evacuee reflected, and here I'm quoting his memoir, his testimony, "Anti-Semitism became intermingled with hatred towards evacuees who had, in a way, taken away part of the living space of the native population." It was not actually in a way. Evacuees were housed with local residents because there was no extra housing space. So this obviously also becomes a source of great tension. So these ideas became overlaid with traditional anti-Semitic tropes about Jewish association with money, this notion that Jews had come and brought about inflation. There are some ideas about how this also has to do with Nazi anti-Semitic notions being filtered onto the home front. I find this less believable than the idea that Jews were simply kind of essentially more visible elements within the evacuee population, and a lot of the frustrations that people had were displaced onto them. And the Jews were plausible scapegoats because of their visibility. And in some cases, locals who couldn't tell between a Jew or a Ukrainian or a Belarusian for their life kind of thought that, oh, maybe all these evacuees are in fact Jewish. Reports from Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, and Kyrgyzstan from the summer of 42 confirmed that repeated incidents of anti-Semitic violence in the Central Asian republics was a matter of concern. All of these authorities kind of noting that this is happening. The Uzbek office of the Commissariat of Internal Affairs reported that overcrowding, the rise in market prices, and the attempts of evacuated Jews to secure jobs within the distribution network had what they described as activated counter-revolutionary efforts towards stirring up anti-Semitism. A report from Kyrgyzstan I found particularly interesting, and here I'm quoting the report that detailed the range of rumors circulating in the area. So the report says that anti-Semitic rumors in the city are basically of the following types. A, the Russians shedding their blood for the homeland because of the Jews. B, prices are so high because of the Jews. And C, Jews are killing the children of other nationalities, drinking their blood and other parts of their bodies to make soup. So that's interesting. there's also like there's also multiple instances, and initially I was really hesitant about believing them. This comes from an official report, but there are multiple instances in memoirs saying that locals kept asking the Jews where their horns were. And I kind of, after seeing it for the first couple of times, I kind of thought, okay, that's probably an exaggeration. This is a memoir that was written like 40 years after the fact. Maybe people are embellishing. But then it comes up enough again and again, and I kind of begin to believe it. So for the rest of the talk, I'd like to focus on some examples of the way in which young Soviet Jews, specifically children and young adults, experienced anti-Semitism in evacuation and the way it might have affected their mentalities. I think this is particularly important to think about because this was a really large group of survivors, and for the Soviet Jewish population that survived the war, that dominated the post-war period, essentially the vast majority of those born in the second half of the 1920s and in the 1930s, who were too young to be recruited to the, mobilized to the front lines, basically, the vast majority of them were evacuation. Otherwise, they wouldn't have survived. Right. So this was a form. I argue essentially that this is a formative experience for most Soviet Jews born in that late second half of the 1920s and the 1930s, except for those select few who would have survived in hiding or in camps, or those who might have been in places like Moscow that was almost conquered, but not exactly. But the Germans didn't make it there, even though Moscow was evacuated. Many of these examples come from testimonies, personal accounts, and oral histories that have been recorded in the last two decades. However, some, and the example that I will end with, comes from archival records from the period of the war. So I see this experience of sort of experiencing anti-Semitism in the wake of evacuation as a moment of, as I mentioned, a formative moment, a loss of innocence in many ways, and a rite of passage for many of these people. Many of these children and young adults write, and this is not just Jews, this is basically everyone, in this generation that, you know, my childhood ended during the war because I couldn't be a child anymore because the circumstances were so difficult. And I had to take on new responsibilities and burdens. For Jews, this often ended up being even more difficult because they were forced to confront this added layer of prejudice. Born in 1937, Naum Bittman was evacuated from Kiev to Frunze in Kyrgyzstan, the site that I had just quoted about the Jews and the blood and making soup. So Bittman recorded in his oral history in 2002. And this is what he said. The only, and I've translated it in Russian, but the only thing that I remember was that I came home and asked Grandma, "Am I a zhid?" They explained to me quickly there. This was the only thing that I learned there, right? So what we have is the circumstances of the particular encounter that prompted Bittman's question remain unknown. So he's on the very young side of that generation. He's born in 37, so he's really little. But their effect upon him was significant. He expresses it as a loss of innocence and introduction to the realities of life. For the youngest group within this population, this was often quite striking. This is kind of what this notion that they repeat, that they came home and said, you know, what is a Jew? Am I a zhid? What does this mean? Why are we Jews? One other evacuee reflected that prior to the war and her family's subsequent evacuation, she simply had no conception of ethnic difference, and her parents avoided discussing the matter altogether. When she asked why other kids got colored Easter eggs for the holiday and she did not, her mother placated her by saying that she would get them another time. And in her words, I thought since I was born in Leningrad, in the territory of the USSR, I was automatically Russian. Displaced to Uzbekistan, Kagan was shocked when one of her classmates in Andijan hit her because she was Jewish. So this is this kind of striking moment that we see among the youngest contingent of this population. Unlike those who were a little bit older, many of them were aware that they were Jewish, but this basically had very little meaning for them. Okay, so I'm Jewish, you know, moving on. Another survivor noted that he was aware that his family was Jewish and that this was why his parents spoke Yiddish. However, prior to the war, the matter of his Jewish identity had not seemed very important to him. Reisk and his mother, this survivor, and his mother and his brother spent the war in the village in the Urals, where he befriended the local boys and adapted well to village life. His idyllic life was shattered one day when a collective farmer called him a zhidonok, diminutive for the pejorative zhid, and exclaimed that Jews like him were to blame for the war, egging on his friends, or his erstwhile friends, to turn against him. He would later write in a testimony that the subsequent beating he received from his erstwhile friends prompted him to come to several conclusions, in his words. And then I understood that I'm not quite like everyone else. Now I was made to understand that to be a Jew is shameful and dangerous to boot. And he actually titles his personal testimony with that phrase, I understood that I'm not quite like everyone else. Upon his return home, Reiskin asked his mother why they had become Jews. At the tender age of 10, he didn't understand how one became a Jew and did not grasp that it was not a choice his parents had made. But in his mind, it had become associated with something disgraceful and undesirable. And again, not all Soviet Jewish evacuees had this experience. A significant number of them did. Of course, it's very hard to come up with statistics because most of our evidence derives from testimonies, so you can't, you just can't get those numbers. But I argue that it is really critical that for significant numbers of people, the notion of Jewishness became linked with this idea of it's something bad, it's something dangerous, it's something that will get you kicked out, or stigmatized, taunted, or bullied. And that it is, it is something that that you cannot escape, but that sets you apart from everyone else. For young adults who had been raised and educated within the Soviet system of values, the lessons that they were forced to internalize during the war proved to be very painful, leading them to question their loyalties and beliefs. So here I'm talking now about a segment of the population that was, basically teenagers. For these people, for that generation, for that group of evacuees, I think the experience was slightly different in that they understood themselves to be Soviet. Many of them had been members of young communist organizations, right? This was something that they were old enough to understand, had been taught in school, and had fully internalized. And then they came to have these experiences in evacuation that proved to be quite jarring and forced them to question these ideas that they had been raised with. They felt deeply the sting of being cast out of a community they had wholeheartedly identified with. I think this is best reflected in a letter sent by a Jewish university student named Eisenberg from Moscow to Ilya Ehrenburg, the prominent Soviet Jewish writer and intellectual, in the spring of 47. So this was the letter was sent April 28, 1947. Ehrenburg was a very prominent figure during the war. He wrote some of the strongest anti-Nazi propaganda that was featured in the Soviet press. I think the rumor, and I don't know if it's true, but that the idea was that when Hitler entered Moscow, he wanted to hang three people: Stalin, Zhukov, and Ehrenburg, right? Because the Ehrenburg was seen as this really important figure within the Soviet press, and became kind of the Soviet Jewish intellectual representative of Soviet Jews. Eisenberg, the student, wrote to Ehrenburg that prior to the war, his Jewishness did not play a significant role in his life. At the age of 6, he was asked in kindergarten about his nationality, and his mother told him he was Jewish. And in his, this is not in his quote, but his letter said, "With that, the cultivation of my national consciousness was at an end." Right. So he came home and he said, "Mom, what am I?" Before the war. So he comes home and he says, "Mom, what am I?" She says, "Well, you're a boy." And he says, no, they asked us in school, it's like a Ukrainian, a Russian, a Belarusian. She says, "Oh, that, okay, you're a Jew." And that, he moved on from that. But then the war comes around and things begin to look different. Before the war, he said that he only remembered that I'm Jewish when filling out forms. The war changed all of that, and Eisenberg learned that he was a Jew. So he writes, you know, he kind of contrasts like the war, like the song did, what was happening on one side of the front and what was happening on the other side of the front. So he said, on the other side of the front, we were killed and burned. Babi Yar, Majdanek, Auschwitz. 7 million murdered Jews, that this says it all. But also on this side of the front, among our own people, Soviet people, with whom we fought together against death, we were not people, but rather zhid. To be persecuted by one's enemies, this is very difficult. But when even your friends begin to come after you, this is more than a person can bear. It is loneliness. It is the fate of our people. We see this sort of response among some of these younger idealistic young Jewish people who feel all of a sudden that this identity is forced upon them and they are really disillusioned. So he continues, and now during the war, I found out that I am zhid, that we the zhids are culpable for all the failures at the front and the inflation on the home front. Moreover, the zhids are to blame for all of Russia's misfortunes. The Germans came to Russia specifically to annihilate them, the Jews. With what pain I saw that our people, those with whom just yesterday we lived, built, and fell together, now scorn us. Mothers would say to their children, be quiet, don't cry, or else the zhid will come. Yes, we learned all the bitterness of national indignity. To illustrate the humiliation experienced by some evacuees, Eisenberg describes an incident that took place in his school in Alma-Ata, in Kazakhstan, the capital of Kazakhstan, in 1943, when a group of fourth graders defecated in the corner of a classroom and forced a Jewish classmate to sit in the feces, with other classmates egging on the perpetrators by name-calling the hapless victim. I sincerely hope that everyone's done with lunch. In his appeal to Ehrenberg, Eisenberg yearns to know what his people have done to deserve his this kind of treatment. And it's interesting that in this quote, he switches essentially when he, at different points in the letter, Eisenberg identifies himself with distinct groups. In the first, he refers to the Soviet citizens as our people, our own people. And then he switches to say that it is the fate of our people. Now he's talking about Jews, right? So this is, I think, emblematic of the tension that many of these individuals are feeling, right? Our people are the Soviet people. We're Soviets. We identify with the Soviet Union. That's who we identify with. But now it turns out that's not quite true. So maybe our people are Jews, and where does that leave us? In another diary that I work with at Yad Vashem. Of a young man from Ukraine, you see that by the end of the war, he kept a very detailed diary, and you see that by the end of the war, he had been evacuated with his mother and then returned home. He essentially endures this personal crisis, basically in the days around the Soviet victory, because he had spent his whole life, he's 15, I think, when the war starts, so he's in his late teens at this point, seeing himself as a Soviet, and all of a sudden he writes about, you know, my people are cast out, my people are not part of this collective, you know, what am I to do, where do I fit in, why does this happen? In another letter, an evacuee, also from Kazakhstan, was so depressed by her circumstances that she wrote to her sister that she wished she had died under the bombardment in Kiev. And she writes how she and her mother and other evacuees from Odessa had been evicted by the local woman they had settled with and effectively rendered homeless. In her letter to her sister, this was during the war, she writes, all the locals here think that the evacuees are not people, but rather dogs, and even worse. And I must tell you the truth that we are not like here because we are Jews. As sad as it is to write this, it is a fact. A horrible anti-Semitism has developed here. I'm not exaggerating this, but it is very painful for me to bear all of this. The Komsomol is the Young Communist League, taught me something very different, that all nations are equal, but here, alas, everything is different. She actually writes later in her letter that she's like, you know, this is not what Stalin taught us, this is not what Gorky taught us, these are not the values that we learned. And she's disheartened that to feel that these values carry little weight in Janibek, in the village where she was resettled. So I'd like to leave time for questions. So I will conclude by kind of, in conclusion, I think it's really important to think about what does this teach us? What is the significance of these stories? I think that the war changed the meanings of Jewishness, not just in the camps and the ghettos of Eastern and Western Europe, and not just in the territories occupied by the Nazis, but also, and as I've discussed here, on the Soviet home front, where the experience of those displaced were not nearly as straightforward as some people assume. And this kind of this is a big part of the larger book project that I work on, that I'm working on, that it looks at evacuation, basically saying we need to understand the complications and the nuances of the home front experience, and that it brought to light many uncomfortable realities that the Soviet Union essentially did not talk about for the 40 years that followed the war, and we're now just beginning to talk about. And I think that it's important to keep in mind that this experience laid the groundwork for what many of these people experienced in the decades that followed, in the wake of Stalin's anti-Semitic campaigns, the creation of the State of Israel, and the changing relationship between Israel and the USSR, and the quota systems of the post-war decades, right? These were clear formative experience of Soviet Jewish, of the post-war generation of Soviet Jews, and we know the stories about the dissident and all of that. I think it's important to keep in mind that for many of those people, many of their formative experiences were in fact an evacuation. And these are parts of their, this is an important part of their story. And also an important part of the story of survival on the Soviet home front. Thank you very much.
So much. So we have about 20 minutes for discussion, questions, comments.
Yes.
It was my understanding, and I could be wrong, that the people who lived in all those stands in Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, didn't have much commerce with Jews. And so I'm wondering if all this anti-Semitism was due to non-Jewish Ukrainians, et cetera, moving east. What do you think?
Yeah, no, it's an important question, and it's hard. I mean, we have the stories that tell us different. I mean, different anecdotes show different sides of these stories, and unfortunately, the official reports almost never mention who are the perpetrators. Like, they don't say, oh, this is coming from the evacuees, or oh, this is coming from the locals. There are significant oral histories that say, okay, the Uzbeks, the Kazakhs, especially the people who live in the rural areas, had no idea who Jews were. Or certainly had no idea who Ashkenazi Jews were. In Uzbekistan, there is a significant population of Bukharan Jews, which are a very different community, and they had their own, they fit into their society, and they had long-standing relations within that community, but they looked very different from the Ashkenazis. I mean, they really weren't associated with each other. You see in some testimonies that the Ukrainian or non-Jewish evacuees helped circulate these ideas. Other sources note that it was demobilized veterans, Red Army soldiers, who had been wounded and were coming to these areas, and then they contributed to spreading these rumors. Obviously, it's clear that Ukrainians don't think the Jews have horns, or they really shouldn't. In some cases, I think that these ideas, particularly maybe not in the stands, but certainly in Siberia, these anti-Semitic rumors became tacked onto traditional Orthodox anti-Jewish ideas about Jews being like little devils, and I think that's how those ideas began to circulate. You also have the role of people who had been deported to those areas, particularly Kazakhstan, before the war. So Kazakhstan Kazakhstan in particular, not just Kazakhstan, is a large republic that is relatively underpopulated, so it became a favorite Soviet dumping ground for all kinds of people. And in the 1930s, some of those people were former people who were labeled as kulaks, undesirables. You know, it's a whole complicated story. In some testimonies, you see that it was those deportees who said, ah, these Jews, they represent Soviet power is bad, the evacuees are Jewish, you know, let's go from there. But it is, I mean, as we know, right, rumors are hard to isolate where they originate in our own society. It's hard to do it when it's, you know, it's been 70 years. Susanna?
Yeah, thank you. This is really, really interesting, disheartening. That's Russian history. And so I have an observation and a question, but you've kind of already answered the question with that answer. But I just want to say how this really rings true with the aspects of my work on World War II, which is about music, Russian folk music, and sort of what happened, what I saw happening in the war was the resurrection of the Russian peasant, who had been essentially erased from popular discourse for the previous 10, 15 years because, you know, peasants were, they didn't exist anymore, you know, we have, that they were backward, we're all Soviets now. And then suddenly, when it's this defense of the land, Russian peasants and Russian peasants in particular suddenly become this really important entity. And so I see in this exactly, it's sort of the other side of that coin. It's bringing back these pre-revolutionary identities, really, and the anti-Semitism was huge then, right?
Yeah.
And then what I was wondering about, and you've already kind of talked about this, was really how the pre-war movements of peoples, whether we saw any of this. So, but not just the people who were being sent away as punishment, but the people that were being sent to the less populated areas, you know, to build the new Soviet state, you know, and then after the war with the Virgin Lands also. So,
I think that in terms of the latter, again, it's because of the nature of evidence, it's hard to know where this really comes from. I do, because on the one hand, you think, okay, Uzbeks and Kazakhs, they don't really care so much about Jews. Why all of a sudden do they adopt these ideas? I think, you know, it really is one of those things, as we understand, that when things become really difficult, you look for people to blame.
Yeah.
And a lot of the evacuees, again, most of them were Russians and Ukrainians and Belarusians, but some of them were Jews. And it's, to me, kind of logical that people, when in expressing these frustrations, you kind of get that it's not a popular thing to say, oh, these Russians, they're creating all of these problems here. It's much more palatable to say, oh, it's the Jews. And I think the fact that the Soviet Union was a place where there had been multiple waves of migration in the 30s meant that there were individuals who had been either deported or who had been sent there for work or for, you know, education, whatever, who kind of could, if they had the will, sort of say, oh, well, it must have to do with these Jews who had, you know, had anti-Semitic ideas that would have existed, you know, predated the Soviet period. I think that it's, in terms of the sort of resurrection of Russian nationalism, certainly during the war, I think this is a part of that story. It's difficult to pinpoint, in part because we do see Soviet authorities writing these reports saying, like, this is not good. We need to do something about the anti-Semitism. This is, you know, we need to clamp down on this. I think in part the state is sort of willing, is not happy about this phenomenon, but on the one hand there's lack of resources. Like, dealing with anti-Semitism on the ground is sort of low on the totem pole when you're trying to, you know, defeat the Nazis. And it's also that they're aware, very aware, that one of the rumors that are circulating is that the Red Army's defeat is out there fighting and dying for the Jews. And Soviet do not want to give credence to that notion that the Soviet Union is there to defend Jews while the Russians and everyone else is dying for the Jews. At the same time, I think one of the most interesting documents that I located in Kazakhstan, actually, when I did research there, was a report, a memorandum by the first secretary of the Communist Party of Kazakhstan, basically the leader of Kazakhstan, writing this memo saying, you know, we have to do something about this anti-Semitism. Everyone, agitation, propaganda, basically, local authorities, tell everyone that anti-Semitism is not okay. And one of the things you should tell them is, think about all of these great Jews who have, who are so important to the Soviet Union and to culture in general. So he says, like, remind them that Marx is Jewish. Remind them about Spinoza. And he just, like, kind of, he gives this list of names of people that they should talk to them about how all of these great people that we venerate are Jewish. And this is summer of 42. So you're like, okay, Skvortsov is clearly, this guy's clearly not on the anti-Semitic bandwagon quite yet. So I push against those who say, well, official anti-Semitism really begins during the war. I think non-official anti-Semitism really begins during the war. Mm-hmm. Not sure that official anti-Semitism really begins during the war.
Right. It's like the pro-Russian nationalism thing, that was a really useful,
yeah.
That was very useful.
Right.
This is a not useful offshoot of that.
Right.
But it's a natural offshoot, then what are they going to do about it?
Yes.
Hi,
Natalie.
Hi.
Hi.
Did Soviet Jews know what the Nazis' intention was to do with them, and two, did the Soviet government purposely evacuate Jews from the German invasion because they knew what the Nazis intended?
Yeah, so those are great questions. There was a lot of discussion earlier about, you know, whether the Soviets intentionally evacuated or did not evacuate Jews, and I think there was no specific policy about Jews being targeted for evacuation or not targeted for evacuation. Soviet Union evacuated not based on nationality. So the Soviet Union largely evacuated through affiliations, so the professional affiliations. So they evacuated defense industries, because you have to have people who, you know, make bullets for the rifles. Or they evacuated key ministries, key Soviet authorities that they wanted to save. They did not go through and say, you know, the Jews need to go or the Ukrainians need to stay. So they simply were not thinking along those lines. That was just not the way that evacuation worked. Or they would say, okay, let's evacuate the women and children, or let's evacuate children's institutions. That was the logic at play. That's kind of the central policy. Now, you do have stories that on the ground, sometimes you had Soviet authorities who were more or less aware of the particular threat the Jews were facing. So there was a great memoir at the Holocaust Museum in D.C. of a young man who came from central Ukraine, and he writes that his father, who had fought, I think, in the Red Army during the First World War, was essentially pulled aside by an authority, one of the Soviet authorities, who told him kind of under the table, like, you guys need to get out. This is not going to go well for you. Now, those were individual decisions that people made. That wasn't a written policy. As to what people knew about what was happening, yes and no. There were reports in the newspapers about Nazi atrocities. Sometimes they talked about Jews specifically. A lot of times they didn't. The diary that I mentioned that was at Yad Vashem, he writes shortly after Babi Yar that, you know, 70,000 Jews were killed, and he knows specifically that they're Jews, so he's getting this from the newspapers. Certainly, people didn't understand. I think didn't know the scale of it, or didn't want to believe the scale of it. So yes and no. I think they're hearing that atrocities are happening. But a lot of people at the same time didn't really believe the Soviet press, so that was also kind of problematic. But for the most part, I mean, it is heartbreaking in that you often see that people didn't really understand until the end of the war on their return that what had happened to their loved ones. Yes.
Thank you. You really recited the story of my grandparents, those who fought the war and those who were buried in the evacuation. I wonder about the state of research, especially in Russia, dealing with everything which happened behind the front lines, because it was a great issue, something which was not addressed directly, something that was a sort of problematic or shameful, so as far as I know. So what happens in that sense in Russian history?
Thank you very much. That's a great, it's a very helpful question for me, because that's a lot of what I've been thinking about right now as I'm preparing book proposals and the rest. The state of kind of the discussion in Russia is somewhat interesting, in that I do think there's been renewed attention in the evacuation, not just in Russia, but in other Israel particularly. Also, to some extent, the United States. We've seen some scholarship here. I was amazed that I found like a collection of documents published by the Tatar archives on evacuation of children during the war, and it was a whole book that they published just of documents on that topic, which I thought was interesting, just because I wasn't sure what they, you know, what would spur them to think that this is what something that they need to dedicate their attention to. Just recently, actually, an organization petitioned President Putin to designate an official day of memory for the evacuation and the accomplishments of the evacuation, in part because the history of the Second World War is such an important narrative for the Russian state and continues to be such an important narrative for the Russian state. This is part of that narrative. But for the most part, it's being discussed there in the context of this success story of we evacuated all of these people survived, this is a good thing. During the Soviet period, this was kind of the narrative that like we evacuated the French of the nations, everyone got along and made a whole lot of, you know, guns for the Red Army, and this is great. I think my sense is that they haven't really moved away from that narrative because it's a narrative that helps serve the certainly the political agenda, and I think it's interesting that these initiatives are coming to the fore now, in part because it's helpful to have these nice stories about how people across people across the Soviet landmass, the Soviet Union, helped one another and saved one another. And I think it sort of shores up the imperial discourse that Putin's government certainly has. This is not to say that didn't happen. There we have plenty of stories about the fact that locals did help evacuees and that there were good relations and that people kept in touch years later and that, you know, humanity essentially came out and people helped one another. So I'm not trying to say that didn't happen. I'm just trying to say that's not the whole story. But the same group that proposed this new holiday or this new day marking evacuation also wants to build what they've dubbed as the most extensive monument in all of Russia, which would be a monument with, you know, one part of the monument in one of the cities that, one of the towns that was the origin for evacuation transports, and another town that received these evacuees, and the idea is that like be a two-part monument separated by 700 kilometers, because there would be like a woman seeing off evacuees in one place and then someone receiving them in the destination. So I would be surprised that if it actually happened, but I think that would be a really interesting a monument. It's also a story that's actually quite helpful for, useful for less, this, you know, it's not a story about Leningrad or Moscow, it's a story about some people from Leningrad and Moscow. It's not really, it's a story that takes place outside of the main places where we talk about, so I think it's also a really useful narrative for these towns and cities that don't usually get talked about, and it's a way for them to say, hey, we participated in this, we're part of the story, and we should get some of the attention.
Sorry, we have time for one more question, and then we can continue it perhaps a little informally.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think that Jews in this area were surprised when you see one or two generations earlier with pogroms from Ukraine and Belarus? Why should they be surprised that there's anti-Semitism when the Soviets took over?
This is something that I'm glad that you bring up, because it's something that I sort of cut out of the presentation. I'm not trying to argue that this is kind of the first time anti-Semitism is a problem in the Soviet Union. It's not. I will say that before the war, the Soviet state did very much. I mean, they had an actual campaign against anti-Semitism, so that this was something that the state was focused on combating. The last upsurge of anti-Semitism before the war is really the late 20s. So there was an upsurge of anti-Semitism in the late 20s, and then from what we see, it's sort of on the decline in the 1930s. Again, it's not to say that it's not there, but it's not, it's not certainly prevalent. And that's also in part why I focus on this generation, because I think it's key to remember that the generation of children and young adults who would have been raised, who wouldn't have remembered the pogroms, and really would only come into consciousness in the 1930s, would not have been privy to those stories. So their parents would be, but it's understandable that their parents would probably not, share those narratives with their children. So I think this is, for this generation, this is an important moment.
Well, thank you so much, Natalie. This was a wonderful talk with much to think about. Few more minutes in the room if you want to take some more food, of which there is a large amount left, so please.